Now, as mentioned earlier, when do you use this? Three different times. Planning, and you'll see in your notes, yellow in the word required. So in the planning phase, required. As an overall review, required. So at the end of the audit and in planning the audit, it is required. What about as a substantive test? So over here, these are our substantive tests. As an analytic procedure, it's recommended. Recommended. Not required, but recommended to use as a substantive test. And you'll see here it says the auditor should complete four steps in using it as a substantive test. What are those steps? Determine the suitability of particular substantive analytic procedures for given assertions. Then evaluate the reliability of data from which the auditor's expectation is developed. Develop an expectation for a recorded amount or ratio and evaluate whether it is adequately precise to identify a misstatement. And then determine the amount of the discrepancy between the recorded amount or ratio and the auditor's expectation that would not require further investigation. So those are kind of the things we're looking at when using it as a substantive test. But planning, required. Substantive, recommended, optional. Overall review, required. Who do you think should be doing these? Now, and this is one of the things I remember when I was the itty-bitty kitty in a cribby. I was the new hire when I was working at Deloitte. And my job was to go into the controller's office. Hi, controller, we're almost done with the audit. Can I ask you a couple of questions? Sure. Okay, inventory went up by 42%. Why? And then you write notes. This changed by 3%. Why? And then you write notes. So we're doing this to kind of ask questions to see. So in doing analytical procedures, we're doing this at the end of the audit as well. This may lead us to go back and do more test of details. Because I'm going to go back and say, hey, why did inventory go up by 17%? Oh, because we bought a new factory. Oh, maybe I need to go out and observe it. Maybe I need to inspect the documentation. Maybe. So it leads you to go back and do more of this. So doing this and planning helps to look at what you need to, you know, accounts that have changed dramatically. Doing it as an overall review is required because it lets you go back and say, hey, maybe there's stuff that I missed in the detail testing. Remember, here, the detail, you're in the trees. Analytical procedures, ratios, you're stepping back and looking at the forest for the trees. You're looking at the overall picture of it. So it leads you to go back and do more of the detail testing. Who should generally do this? In the real world, who did it? I did it, the new hire. In the exam world, who do you think should do it? And I love this answer under overall review. It says, this should be performed by the manager or partner with overall knowledge of the client's business and industry. Okay, yeah, sure, that would be nice. Like the partner. The only time I see the partner is on day one when he takes the client to lunch and on the last day when he sends the bill and takes the client to lunch. That's about it. What about the managing partner? That's the partner in charge of the whole office. When do you see them? You see them at the holiday party. That's the picture of them in the office when they were like 27 years old. Now they're like 143, all right? And you're like, who's that old guy? Oh, that's the guy. And you're like, I saw the, it doesn't look like the picture. That's the man, the managing partner, no. Who would do it? The manager or the partner, that would generally do it. So the ultimate purpose is to form an overall conclusion as to whether the financial statements are consistent with the auditor's understanding of the entity.